Lord, we put our trust in you, oh Lord. Because victory is yours, oh God. I don't know what your need is, but I stand here to remind you that whatever you need can be found in the man called Jesus. If you need peace, he is Jehovah Shalom. If you need provision, he is Jehovah Jireh. If you need love, that is who he is. You need deliverance, he is our deliverer. You need healing, he is Jehovah Rapha. Oh God, we put our trust in you. Oh Lord, 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 Lord. Cause you will deliver, you're a provider. I find my victory in forever victorious. Forever, Lord, we win.
You will deliver.
You're my provider.
You're a provider. I find my victory in you.
Forever victorious.
Forever
we win. Victory belongs
to Jesus. Victory belongs to him.
It all belongs to
victory
you.
Victory belongs to Jesus.
Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my. Oh, what a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of what a beautiful name, what a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name, the name of my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ the King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares. The name of Jesus.
You were the word
at the beginning. One with God,
the Lord Most High.
Oh Lord,
your hidden glory.
Now revealed in you, Christ.
What a beautiful name it is.
The name of Jesus Christ. Mike, what a beautiful name.
Nothing compares.
Oh, what a beautiful name it is, the name. didn't want heaven without us. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, but your love.
Sin was great, your love was great.
Nothing could separate us now.
What could separate us?
What a
now.
Wonderful name. Wonderful name it is. Nothing compares.
Nothing compares.
Yeah, what a wonderful name it is. The name. What a wonderful name. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ. What a the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival.
You have no equal.
Now and forever.
For
Ourselves, we said Jesus is the answer. And among the things we have done, we have asked ourselves, does he qualify to be the answer? And we show from scripture that he qualifies. One of the things I want to emphasize again is that the final act of Jesus in his humanity was when he died, when he gave himself on Calvary. That was the final. And last week we asked ourselves, why Calvary? And one of the things we discussed was that Calvary facilitated the perfect sacrifice. It means Jesus could not have died anywhere else but on the cross. They tried many times to kill him, They took us told many times to stone him. And the idea was to have him die. And you will read in the gospel that when such times did come, he would actually make himself invisible, pass out among them, and they wouldn't see him. It was not that Jesus was afraid to die. Matter of fact, he said, no man taketh my life from me. I lay it down of myself that I may take it up again. This commandment have I received of my Father. So you are not afraid to die, but he knew that he had to die in the appropriate place. When John saw him, John said in chapter 1, verse 29, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. And he was the Lamb of God made human, put that way. And every lamb in the Levitical priesthood had to be offered on an altar of sacrifice. If somebody killed a lamb in the forest, it was not accepted as sacrifice. It had to be slain, and the flesh had to be burnt on the altar of sacrifice. That burning signified the judgment of God coming down upon the offering of sacrifice. So the altar, and in the book of Hebrews, it is so whereby Jesus had the perfect altar. Not like the where the flesh of bulls and goats and ram and heifer and kids were slain. He said the perfect sacrifice was offered on the perfect altar, and that altar was Calvary. He had to die on Calvary. So breaking his neck would not have been in the purpose of God. Stoning him would not have been in the purpose of God. Pushing him over a cliff would not have been in the purpose of God. He had to die on Calvary. That was his final act in his humanity, the cross. But the Bible declared that God raised him again from the dead. And having raised him, he did not just simply raise him and tell him, well, come back and, you know, relax yourself. He exalted him, according to Ephesians chapter 1, and gave him a name which is above every name. And he also highly exalted above principalities and powers and dominion and every name that is named. And what did God do after that? He put all things in subjection under him. And having done that, he now do what? He gave him to the church, which is his body. And as you know, the church is not a building. The church is composed of people. You are the church. So you have the church to the Corinthians, the church to the Ephesians, the church to the Philippians, the church to the Galatians. The church is not the building. You know, as I was thinking about that, and we thank God for the Roman church, the church of Rome. I'm not talking about the Catholic church, I'm not talking about the Roman church, Romans and Galatians and Colossians and Corinthians, the church of Smyrna. Do you know that those churches never had a building like we have? They met in groups. There was no big cathedral. They met in groups like this. But you're called the church. So the building does not define the church. People define the church. When people want to know what kind of a church Rhema is, they look at the Rhema people. How they live, how they behave, how they act, how they speak. Their attitude, that is what a church is. So having done that, we went across to Hebrews chapter 4 that we did last week, and we're going to look at that again today. And I'm continuing we began talking about where Paul, I believe he's the writer of Hebrews, Paul in chapter 4, he said, let us therefore fear. And that fear, according to the Greek, does not mean to be afraid of or to panic. Neither does it mean to reverence or to worship or to revere. It means to be careful. It means to be resolute. It means to be certain, to take care. Take care that you don't come to a point where you actually miss the promise. So he said, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Well, I don't want to preach what I preached last week because we'll never finish. But the point we made was, there's a possibility that the people of God can miss what God has intended for them to have. Now, the Bible does not indicate that if you miss it, you're going to hell. It doesn't say that. Many people have lived their lives, and I'm talking about the greater part of their life, serving God, and they never ever came into the realization of enjoying the pleasure that God intended for them to enjoy. Never. Because their head is in the cloud waiting for the sweet by and by. I believe, and according to Scripture, that God intend for us to live abundant life upon the face of the earth. And that does not only mean health-wise, it means prosperity, it means in every area of your life, you'll be a success. And Paul is saying, let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest. Any of you, let me make sure I'm not putting my own words here, that any of you, I'm correct, will come short of it. Fall short. They mean failing to come to their realization, failing to possess, failing to have a demonstration of what God has left in our life. You remember, according to Romans chapter 3, that says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So any the unsaved person comes short of the glory of God. What does God do? Does God say, okay, I believe I set my standard too high, so I'll come down a little lower? No, God does not. God remains God. He remains holy, just, righteous, wise, powerful. He's God. He's not going to change to facilitate our weaknesses. So the unsaved person must come to God through the provision that God has made. And that provision is his son, Jesus. Now, when that person becomes saved, become born again, he now enters into the environment where every single thing that Jesus gave his life to secure can become his or hers. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. So it's the same word that was used for short in Romans 3, used for short in Hebrews 4 and verse 1. And that could happen to anybody. Why? Lest any of you, will come short of it. Any of you. So, this tells me that each of us has a personal, individual responsibility to take a hold of the promise of God. Every one of us, individually. Now, when we understand that, our focus and many times our confession will change. Because, you see, beloved, it is not unusual that you can find yourself in the position where you become an analyst. You're analyzing everybody who ain't living right. You analyze everybody who ain't doing the right thing. And you even say, well, you know, I want to go somewhere where people are living for God seriously. You know what I mean? And you become like a judge. You become an analyst, analyzing, knowing how everybody else should live. And Jesus put it the way that I couldn't put it. You think that Jesus didn't have a little sense of humor? He said, why do you behold the mote in your neighbor's eye and can't see the beam in your own eyes? Who said that? Jesus. What is an example? You have a whole 4x4 big plank in your eye, and it ain't bothering you, but a little piece of shaving in somebody's eye and that bothering you. That's what you're saying. If Paul has said that, or if I had said that, you know, take up some stone to stone me. You see that man insulting, eh? I ain't going back there now, he doesn't insult people. No, not that. It's Jesus who said that. So we can find ourselves knowing how everybody else should live and allow it to have a negative effect upon our own life. Rather than becoming busy taking a hold of what God has prepared for you, you become distracted by who ain't living right or who's doing the wrong thing. And not realizing that when you stop to observe doing the wrong thing, you come to a standstill. You stop moving. If you move at all, it's backwards. But not forward. Because you're more concerned about what other people are doing, you can't even see God when God is moving. Am I preaching too hard this morning? I'm just trying to make a point. Where Paul says, lest every one of you, or any one of you. So, beloved, we got to come to a point, you know, at one time when Jesus in the book of John, I think John, the last chapter of John anyhow, went after he asked Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep, feed my lamb, feed my sheep, etc. And then after the Lord had actually talked with him, he said, come follow me. And Peter began to follow Jesus. And Peter looked back and see a guy, I think it was John, following. And Peter said, Lord, what he will do? And the Lord said, if he follow me, what is your, that not your business? He said, you follow me, forget him. So Peter was more concerned about what he could do. The Lord said, that is not any your concern. Your concern to follow me. I have plans for him. And the plans I have for him are between he and me. Not you and he and me. You and me. He said, you follow me and let me deal with him. For the same way I have a plan for you, have a plan also for him. Am I making sense, beloved? So I'm trying to advise you. I'm trying to encourage you. I'm trying to edify you. Become busy getting all that God has in store for you. I remember many years ago, I made a statement, and some people look at me with a kind of a quirky eye, and I make it again. I said, it matters not how long I live upon the face of the earth, involving myself in ministry. I said, God will not be allowed to leave me out of any move that he innovates upon the face of the earth. Any move of God, revival or what? I got to be a part of that. I said, God is not going to leave me out. And I made the statement, even Buddha said, I'm not going to allow him to leave me out. So I said, you forget the idea that you hear him from God and I hear him from God. That point I was trying to make to them. I said, you get that out of your mind. You know, there are some guys, you know, who have the idea that they are the latest find, that God himself is lucky to have found them. They are the latest. And all people like me and so on, old-timish, you know, so our days are done. Why don't you just simply sit and keep yourself quiet? I said, you forget that. There will be no move of God in this country that I will not be a part of. God is not going to leave me. He's not going to skip me over at all. I'm going to make sure I am in a place where when God speaks, I hear him. When God moves, I am a part of the move. When God brings revival, I'm a part of that revival. And I mean that. And I'm saying that to encourage us. You don't need to sit down like an empty barrel and people have the idea that they have all the package from God and they can come and talk, dump it inside you because you are so dumb and because you are so empty. No, don't allow anyone to insult you. The same God whom they serve is the same God whom you serve. And the Bible says, any of you and what promise that God had left, he left it for you. That lest any of you should come short of the glory of God. So last week I introduced what I call a tragedy. So Hebrews chapter 4, and let's take from verse 9 to 11 and see how it goes there. Hebrews chapter 4, from 7. Okay, let's take from verse 7. Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, now that word there is to be Joshua in the Hebrew. You understand? It's not Joshua the deliverer. So he's comparing and contrasting the behavior of believers under the old covenant with believers under the new covenant. So Jesus was never in the old covenant. It was Joshua. He said, so if Joshua had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remained therefore a rest to the people of God. That's verse 8. Yeah, 9. So remember we said last week, we have the creation rest. After God had created the heaven and the earth in 6 days, he rested on the 7 days. Then we have the sabbatical rest, where God gave the commandment to Moses to pass on to them. Then we have the Canaan rest, where Joshua, after Moses died, Joshua took them into Canaan. So when they got into Canaan, the journey was over. There was no more journeying. So we had creation rest, sabbatical rest, and Canaan rest. But here is Paul saying, if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken again of another day. So in other words, those three rests, do not disqualify another day when God wants to give us perfect rest. And the person who gave us that perfect rest, his name is Jesus. So in his humanity, he declared in Matthew chapter 11, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So the Bible is saying, in spite of the creation rest and the sabbatical rest and the Canaan rest, there still remains a rest for whom? The people of God. Now that is what the writer is talking about in chapter 4. Take heed you don't come short of entering into the rest. So there remains a rest for whom? The people of God. Not for some at the exclusion of others. If you are a person who belongs to God, say amen. A little louder. Amen. If you ain't quite too sure, say I ain't quite sure. Right. So we are quite sure that we are the people of God. There remain therefore a rest. What is the rest? The embracing of the conclusive work of Jesus' work of redemption. That has been done. And God has it there for you and for me. And beloved, I don't want you to ever get in your mind that when the Bible speaks of these nice things, it speaks about some other people and not you, because you ain't good enough. Because you ain't mature enough. The only person whom this does belong to is the person who isn't born again as yet. But as soon as they get born again, guess what? They come into the circle. They come into the environment. They are partakers of the thing. And Paul is begging, please, for God's sake, don't come short. And we spent the whole service last week, Sunday, with the 15th, talking about coming short. We gave about 8 different points there. So we said, this is the tragedy, that people can live their life, all their life, and coming short of the promise. Always get in your mind what the Bible is talking about. May come short of it. What is it? The rest. Okay? How are you looking at me like that? Let me make sure. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest. Okay? Any of you will seem to come short of it. That it there is the rest. So you can be saved and come short. And to remind you again from last week, remind you again, I taught this week on yet, eh? To remind you to come short. Come short means to be inferior. You feel yourself inferior. Come short means to be deficient. I wish that God had really blessed me that I could have, you know, but here I'm living from paycheck to paycheck. And I take breakfast this morning, and I know where the lunch will come from, but I'm trusting God that somebody will come and bring me some food. And the kids are going to go to school next week, and they send me a book list there, the book list, big like that. And books these days are so expensive. My God, I know I'm going to make out now. I'm going to take them out to, you know. And you could begin to just murmur because I don't understand. Come short me to be deficient of the promise that has been left to you. What is the promise? That God has completely secured on the basis of the finished work of Calvary. How do I get there? I'm trying to show whereby we can come to a point where we complain about what is hard, and we deficient, live our life in deficiency, come short. To come short means to fail to grasp every single benefit that God has in store for you. How? By your resting in the finished work of Calvary. Rest. There remain therefore a rest. When you got saved, you entered into his rest. And that has nothing to do if you belong to a church board, or you're a preacher, or you're asked to read the scripture, or you're asked to be the host, or you're asked to open prayer. It has nothing to do with your function. It has everything to do with your position. You are in Christ. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All the things are passed away, and behold, all the things are become new. That's who you are. You are entitled. So that is a tragedy, that any of us can come short. And then speaking, complaining against God, and say God isn't fair. So I began that by trying to make an example. So God began to bless us. And one morning, the phone rang, the house phone. And the person on the other end was very sarcastic. He said, "But Anthony, I heard that you now enter into your new Jerusalem. You buy a house and you have so and so." I said, "Who is speaking?" He said, "That's not important. I'm a brother in the Lord." He said, "Yes, you enter into your new Jerusalem now. You have it?" He said, "Boy, what I plan to do is to come and live near to you so some of the blessing can rub off on me." Sarcasm, you know. That is my crime. Because God blessed me, and I was able to do different things. That is problem. I said, "Brother, let me tell you something. If you could get so close to me, closer than the clothes I wear, you could stick yourself onto me like a suck stone." You know what suck stone is? It's a little fish that will suck itself into a stone, and you can't get it released. It have a flat belly and it's suck stone. I said, you can come and stick on yourself to me. Unless you can believe God like I believe God, you will die a scrunter. That might sound hard language, but I meant it. I said, not how close you get to me. It's in knowing the God I know. It's in believing God like I believe God. And it doesn't matter how close you live to me, how close you stick to me, you got to know God for you. And until you get to know God, you will live your life as a scrunt until you die. I said, it doesn't matter because you didn't tell me who your name is. He said, okay then. And he hung up. You see, we have the idea that God could bless some and don't bless others. No, beloved. Get that out of your mind. God wants to bless you. If God can bless me, God can bless you. The same God, look what the Bible said. The same God overall is rich unto all that call upon him. My God. The same God. God and I have been having a kind of a conversation these last days. You want to hear it? I said, God, come on now. I said, you declare in your word, Lord, that you are the everlasting God, you change not. I said, God, I don't argue that. I believe it with my heart, my soul, my mind, my clothes. I believe that you are the everlasting God. You change not. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. I said, God, look. A guy called Elisha. Elisha died and was buried. How long he buried for? We don't know, but it had to be a long time because his flesh had totally decomposed and only bones were left. And a man died and they were burying him. But they dug up Elisha's grave by mistake. And when they let down the corpse in the grave, the corpse touched Elisha's bones. And there was enough anointing in the bone to call that body to become alive again. Am I talking scripture? The dead was quickened and lived because the dead body touched Elisha's dead bones. There was still anointing in those bones to quicken a dead. I say, God, I am alive. I ain't dead. Where is that quickening power? So why must I lay hand on a sick and the sick ain't getting better? Are you not Elmore Anthony's God like you are Elisha's God? So God and I usually have a nice conversation. I said, God, I expect that. And many times I said, God, I am alive. People who could touch me are alive. And nothing happens. So something wrong, not with you, God, something wrong with me. I have come short in that area. to the God, show me where I've come short. I say, show me, God, show me. Because I want to claim Elisha's God as my God. I say, God, you have given a recommendation about a man called Moses. You said, although you're 120 years old, his strength did not wane, neither did his eyes grow dim. I said, God, you see these eyes here? These eyes ain't going to get no dim. And don't tell me nothing about no glasses, God. This fellow rude, eh? I said, God, I expect in my 90s to be still strong like a lion. Because Moses' strength did not wane. Neither did his eyes grow dim. Now, if you're wearing glasses, don't think I'm trying to attack you. No, not at all. I'm saying what I'm believing God for. For this guy named Elmo Anthony. I'm not going to stop until it happens to me. I'm not going to fall short. The God whom we serve. The tragedy is we knowing this thing, fail to embrace it. So let me go into what I prepared for today. Oh my God. So, Pastor, all the talk, you ain't going to your thing yet? No. Don't get afraid. I'm going to stop at half past. I won't go beyond it. I won't go beyond. You know. But I just thought it's important to emphasize something, even though you said it already. You know. So don't get no headache. I'm going to stop at half past, as usual. I'm going to stop at given time. So here we go. So Paul is saying, there remain therefore a rest for the people of God. So what I'm going to talk about now is how can we take a hold of that promise? I mean the rest rather. It's not that we ain't saved. We are saved. We are the people of God. There remaineth the rest for the people of God. So I'm going to be talking now. How do we take a hold of that? Because everybody said, don't fall short. You can fall short. We said, don't fall short. And so we come to read the book of Ephesians, chapter 1. Anybody tell you from Bible school days that my three books were Romans, Ephesians, and Hebrews. I love those books. So look at Ephesians chapter 1. And verse 17. Now Paul is saying in verse 15, he heard about the faith of the Ephesian people and their love and so on. It has spread and they were a blessing to other churches. They were a blessing to Asia and Asia Minor. You know, Ephesians is in Turkey. You know that, don't you? Ephesians is in Turkey. Now, Turkey is now about 100% Muslim. But the most powerful church in the time of Paul was the Ephesian church. What went wrong? Something would have had to go wrong. Turkey is now one of the strongest Muslim countries in the world. But at one time it was the strongest Christian witness. So something went wrong. So Paul is saying to them, after he heard about their faith and their love, he said, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Look at what he prayed for. that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. You can leave it up there. That God, he talking to whom? Christians. The most powerful church in Asia and in Europe. He praying that God will give them the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Now, these are people who knew Jesus as Lord. These are people who knew Jesus as Savior. These are people who had received the Holy Spirit already. But Paul is now saying, I'm now praying that God will give the spirit of wisdom and revelation. He's saying, I want to ask God to take you to the next level. Yes, you have the Holy Spirit. Yes, you have a knowledge of Jesus. He has changed your life. He has filled you with his love. But I'm praying that for something additional, something promotional, something on the other level will happen to you. That God will give you, you who are so spiritual, you who are so full of God, you who are so full of the Holy Ghost, you who are so full of maturity. I'm praying that God give you the spirit of revelation. I want you to underline that word, revelation. Beloved, that which you already know must become now revelation knowledge. You see, you can know something from your finiteness. But God is saying, the Bible says, God wants to give you an infinite knowledge. He's talking now about the Spirit opening the eyes of your understanding, your very soul, your very psyche. That what you have is no longer head knowledge. What you have is revelation. It's like a burning flame on the inside. It's like a reservoir has burst its wall on the inside. It's like an inferno that burning and can't be quenched. You see, that is what I'm praying for. Revelation, knowledge. Now, the word revelation comes from the Greek word apokalypsis. Apokalypsis. That means a manifestation. It means a disclosure. That which is pent up on the inside, God wanted to become manifest. When I say Jesus is the answer, I mean that from the depth of my soul. When I say Jesus is the answer, my language of I can't afford that is forever gone. It is dead. I am saying I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That is what revelation is about. When God burns it into your spirit, he makes a disclosure. Jesus is the only one, and he, by virtue of having been raised, he has left us certain documents. And it is no longer classified, it is declassified. You have access to it. Revelation, knowledge, disclosure. So Jesus has disclosed everything that belongs to you as a child of God, entitled to the promise of God, entitled to the rest. The rest is the rest in the complete work of Calvary, the complete work of redemption. It is now disclosed. The secret is taken away. So nobody has the authority to say, what I have received from God is mine, and I keep it close to my chest. Close to my chest. You already know the price I pay for this now. Yeah, the price I pay. And therefore, if you're trying to get to the game, you better change your mind, because I pay a price for this. Come on, you ain't paying no price. The only man who paid a price, his name is Jesus Christ. And whatever you have is not because you're better off than anybody, it's because you took a hold of it. And don't you ever get the idea that when God began to use somebody in a rich way, you say, the thief in your gift, the thief in my gift, they're trying to thief my gift. Nobody could thief any place. It's a gift. So you didn't work for it. You didn't work for it. But thank God for you. You take a hold. You're not content to be just simply mediocre, or to be normal, or to be natural, or to be ordinary. You press and you push. You take a hold of God. You say, God is like a fellow called Jacob. When Jacob understood that he was holding on to an angel, he said, fella, you may be an angel, but I ain't going to let you go now until you bless me. He is saying, I am tired of being called Jacob, which means the supplanter. He said, I'm tired. I'm a swindler. I don't like my reputation. I don't like my character. And when he realized it was not Esau, but like an angel, he said, okay, I can hold you. And he held on to an angel. He said, you will get away only after you bless me. He was tired of being a failure. He was tired of being a trickster. Tired of being a swindler. And he held on to an angel. You see, before he knew an angel, he thought of Esau. Because Esau had avenged, had planned rather, to avenge him. So when he fell asleep, and he held on, I believe he closed the eyes. And he was maybe saying, one of us go dead here, boy. Not me. But maybe you. But when he realized it was an angel, he said, bless me. Bless me. Angel said, Jacob, the morning is coming. Let me go. He said, no. I don't care. Could be morning, could be night. I don't care. Bless me. And the angel, to get away, had to take his hand and hit him right around here. And he leave him with a limp. Still limping. He dead limping. And when God saw what did, God said, now I know. Because you have wrestled with God and prevail. Hallelujah. Because you have held on and you have prevailed. I'm going to change your name from Jacob to Israel. And from him came the, we call the 12 tribes of Israel. Jacob, the house of Jacob. And Israel is referred to as the house of Jacob. Not the house of Isaac, but the house of Jacob. Because the man was tired of being what he was. Did not like what you're seeing. Did not like what you're doing. Did not like how you're behaving. He said, I am tired being the old man that I am. I want a change. And God saw the hunger, God saw the passion, and God saw the intensity in the man. And God said, you are now a prince with God. Your name shall be called Israel. A prince. Why? Because you prevail. Am I making sense, beloved? That which we know will become revelation knowledge. You see, knowing, the Bible says in the same book of Ephesians, don't turn to it because I'm going to finish now. I'll build on that next week, Sunday. I'm hoping that I'll end it next week, Sunday. I'm hoping so. In the third chapter of Ephesians, among the things that Paul prayed for them is that they will be filled with knowledge that passes knowledge. It means, it sounds funny, eh? The love of God that passes knowledge. In other words, with your humanness, you can't capture the knowledge of God. It will become revelationary. So when we know something, and let the Holy Spirit of God breathe upon it and remove the shell or remove the veil and make us the full extent, it will remain just that. Head knowledge. I remembered I was in Queens with Dr. Boyd helping him with his crusade. You heard me say it so many times, but it just come in handy. And it was Thursday afternoon, exactly 1:30 in the afternoon, of preparing the message for the night. Had a huge tent, seated about 5,000 people, a massive tent he had there. And I'm there that Thursday afternoon preparing the message for the night service. And what I was preparing had nothing to do with what God revealed to me. And out of nowhere, totally not according to what I'm preparing, the Lord said to me, the word of God is livable. I said, what? Where did I come from? So I stopped and I wrote it down. The word of the Lord is livable. So I wrote it down and I continued preparing for the night service. And when I came back the night after the service, like the Lord wanted me to understand that I must understand what he's saying. And out of nowhere, my mind went right back to my days in elementary school in St. Vincent. Every time the Lenten season came around, we had to be able to repeat the three temptations of Jesus. And we had to say them word for word. If you say A where there's Z, they stop you. So I remember the first temptation. If you are the Son of God, command this stone that they be made bread. So I've known the three temptations of Jesus since in elementary school. I know them. With my ears clogged, with my eyes closed, I can repeat them in order. The first one, the second one, the third one. And give you verbatim. And when the Lord said to me, the word of the Lord is livable, he brought that back to me. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by bread. So the word is livable. And from that day in Queens, my life has not been the same when it comes to the word. The word of God was meant to regulate how you live. The word of God was meant to happen. Was meant to happen to you. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I shall be healed. My God supplies all your need. My need shall be supplied. Now, if my need not supplied, it does not mean I backslide. No. If my need is not supplied, it does not mean because I'm sick, I backslide. It takes me back to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 1. We should be careful not to allow it, to miss it, to fall short. So I may fall short. I love God. I love with all my heart and soul, but I can live my life dominated by sickness. You know why? Because my language does not coincide with the word. I have a different language. Well, you know, in this world, you must have something. Something going to take you. Either high blood pressure or diabetes or something, you know. But my life is in the hand of the Lord and in God's own time. I believe in God, you know, in God's own time. But something must take you. You can't have everything nice, you know. You must have something. We say it many times. So we are conflicting with the promise. We love God. We say we love him. We love him. We love him. But our language is contradicting the word. Well, you know, boy, do we think they're going? I know I'm gonna make out now. You see, I mean, when January comes, it's guava season, you know. It's real guava season. So, I mean, you got to brace yourself for hard time, you know. You got to brace yourself for hard time. So we make up our mind that when January comes and you get patience in December for January, you got to suck Tulum. You know what I mean? We have the idea. So we're not expecting. Oh, we said, well, you know, boy, you know, anytime you see the middle of the month come, things hard. Because, I mean, by the 15th and the 17th, everything run out, you know, so it's hard, boy. So we have ourselves positioned that half month got to be hard. Because it's only halfway since the month done. Halfway before the other one come. So we got to have some hard time because half month. You got the idea I'm making? So not that we don't love God, but our expectation is according to our culture. Boy, don't let them addle your brain now. Something must happen to you. something must happen. So somebody said, you know, catch the thing. What thing are you talking about? The thing that's going wrong going wrong now. I catch the thing. They say it's dengue. So I catch it. What I should ask you to do is to contact the West Indies selector and tell them you're a good catcher. You catch it. You know, you catch it. You catch the thing. So our culture tells us we should expect certain things. We who love God, we forget what the Bible is saying. Not until we change our language and speak what the Bible says. So I said to you about a month ago, if I pray for you and you ain't get healed, I am not going to stop praying for the sick. I'll pray for the other sick person and for the other sick person, because I believe the Lord said, I am the Lord that healeth thee. I will take sickness from the midst of thee. And the failure for someone to get healed does not stop me exercising the healing ministry. He said, lay hand on the sick. So I'll keep on laying hand on the sick. And they shall recover. So Paul is reminding us again, take heed, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you will seem to fall short. Because we have an example, those to whom the gospel is preached fell short. Why? Because what they heard was not mixed with faith. And the same chapter of Hebrews 4 says, why they fail? It's because they had no faith. So he said, be careful that you don't fall in the same basket having no faith after you have heard the word of God. Amen. Amen. And some folks say, why would he stop? So I'm going to stop right now. And I trust, beloved, that something is making sense to us. I really trust so. And stop cheating yourself. What has been happening to you, according to the word, take the word of God like a mirror and say, God, you said so and so, but it didn't happen to me. It's not because you, God, are a liar. Something in me failed to accept that or to take a hold of that. Something in me. So the shortcoming is in me, not in you, God. So I take a hold, and I'm not going to rest until I come in to the realization of what you're saying. For the word of the Lord is right. The word of the Lord is forever settled. The word of the Lord is yea and amen. Therefore, ask yourself, don't be content to stop there. Ask yourself, Lord, what am I not doing right? Maybe I can change my confession, change my language, change something. Because you are always right, God. And I trust, God, that we'll come to a point where we are honest enough. Stop making excuses and say, God, the mere fact that you said so and it didn't happen to me, I have fallen short. But I'm not going to stop there. And I say again, it's not because you backslide. You maybe got to look and see what your confession has been. What is your expectation? What is the culture that you hold on to? Could we stand, please?